God, thank you that the breath that we breathe is your spirit. There is no life apart from you. We can do nothing apart from you. Every good and perfect gift in our lives is from you, and abundant life is the only version you offer. Help me, help us, help the world. Long for your abundant life and recognize any fraudulent version of it. We want you. You want us. Give us the grace to love your great love back. Thank you for everyone in this room. Every single person who needs this word is here. Come, Holy Spirit. Amen.
Okay, I could no more type the phrase how to train an evangelist without saying what I really want to say is how to train your dragon, but I just kind of felt like if that was like the opening slide, that's just a little aggressive, that might upset some of you, thinking that an evangelist is a dragon. I think that would be amazingly cool, but you know, I want to be sensitive, so. But while I'm talking about this, think this, because I just didn't want to use this slide to begin, because it, because I want to focus a lot on how we train ourselves to do this hard work. But if there's one phrase that I would like to animate this time and maybe beyond it, is this from Rowan Williams, the former Archbishop of Canterbury. The purpose of the church is to form people into the kinds of people who can receive the gifts God wants to give. There's a lot going on there. But everyone always says this in a talk. I really mean this. I could literally stop talking now. I tend to change this phrase. It was spoken to me. I mean, it was in person. I can't give you a reference to it. This is something Rowan said the last time he was in Washington, D.C. And he just said it off the cuff. And I continue to use it, and I put the word evangelism actually into it. The purpose of evangelism is to form people into the kinds of people who can receive the gifts God wants to give. When I go into a dog park or a coffee shop or Jiffy Lube or anywhere I've gone, to my dermatologist, anything, I go into a room not working for the salvation of anyone. Not that the salvation doesn't need to be worked out by everyone, with fear and trembling, says St. Paul. But that's not my project. This is my project. My Jewish dermatologist, who's a survivor of the Holocaust, his relatives, I go in there, and the reason I am as joyful and energetic and all up next level, and my friends are like, yeah, but he's Jewish. I'm like, the purpose of evangelism is to form people into the kinds of people who can receive the gifts that God wants to give. If it's a relationship with Jesus, then that's up to God to give it to him. It's up to me to form him and myself all the time into the kind of person who can receive the gifts that God wants to give. Salvation and redemption, these are parts of the gifts. So is healing and humor and reconciliation and truth. So I will walk right up to an imam at an interfaith event, and my job is the exact same. Form people into the kinds of people who can receive the gifts that God wants to give. Because buried in this is the Anglican, Catholic, and to some degree Orthodox conviction that we can't give any of those other gifts that for centuries we thought we were arriving to share. Those are not ours to give. No one else's salvation belongs to me. I can't give it to them. And the picture, the reason we have that picture again of the encounter with the woman at the well and Jesus for you to take home, take that, put on your refrigerator, put on your computer. That's why there's more than there are people at each table. Is this idea, is that's what we're called to do, to bring about encounters with God. Have someone when they encounter you, and we'll say in a minute, there's so much more than just talking. In one sense, I'm a terrible person to teach evangelism. Do not put an extrovert in charge of teaching evangelism because the majority of our church is not extroverted. Bishop Curry, and there are some of us who have, it's a Myers-Briggs thing, it's an Enneagram thing, it's a personality thing that has nothing to do with holiness and mission. We happen to have certain gifts that people associate with evangelism, which shows how disgustingly narrow our definition of evangelism is. On the other hand, I can't find anyone else who wants to teach evangelism at the seminary who's just like an introvert or an IN, whatever. I don't even know how to spell the Myers-Briggs that begins with I, but, you know, consonants after that. But if you have, let me know if you know someone, because they should be able to teach evangelism too. This is our theology, that when I show up to someone with the living water of my testimony of knowing God, I'm sort of Jesus in this picture, representing the incarnation of the Lord in someone, which is what you are if you've been baptized. That's not a brag. That's a theological statement. Christ in me, the hope of glory, you are showing up with the water. You don't work for Jesus. This is what's so terrifying and beautiful. You are the Christ to someone. Period. Anything else is you just doing Simon Says with Jesus over there, hoping you get it right with this person, like your Jewish dermatologist. No. Not the baptized. It's not your water, but it's also not your life anymore. You're a faucet. And the person you're sharing the water with is living. There's only one kind of life. Jesus said, I don't care who they're praying and who they're doing it in the name of. There's one good and one God. They're not rival gods. I just wanted to let you know something that's coming that I hope sort of reflects a little bit of what I mean when I talk about teaching evangelism. On your table, by the way, are these cards, if you haven't seen them yet. I brought these with me. These from the first day I ever heard Michael Curry say that we are the Episcopal branch of the Jesus movement. It was years ago. I'd never heard that before, but I wasn't born in the Episcopal Church, and at the time he first said it, I was just really getting involved in, like, you know, varsity denominational stuff. And I was like, oh, that's a lovely phrase. And everyone around me was like, you've never heard Michael Curry say that before? And I hadn't. But as soon as I heard it, I had this image of a branch on a tree. And then he started talking so much about evangelism, and then I got to know him and work with him on evangelism, and I kept thinking, you know, where are evangelists on the tree? You know, are they climbing up? Are they planting trees? What are they doing? And then it occurred to me that the joy, Jesus, who for the joy set before him endured the cross. Joy is an experience of life in the Trinity, so it's always possible. There aren't seasons of joy. We have seasons in the church where we're asked to encounter it in different ways, but they're not seasons of joy. Even remember, we go to the grave singing hallelujah. So I thought, what's the joy? So then I just started picturing it's a swing. Evangelists are moving. Maybe they're singing. But they're off the ground. They've already begun their ascension, because that's what resurrection and redemption are. So they're off the ground, they're singing, they're moving. I'm like, it's a swing. Then I'm like, there's got to be a rope ladder, though, because there's got to be a way in and a way up. As C.S. Lewis says about Narnia, further up, further in. So I hooked up with an artist, and we designed this picture and gave it as a present to Bishop Curry a few weeks ago. And he just about lost his stuff. And then since then, we've actually made it in Spanish as well. And I said that the seminary wanted to give it to him, but we've also given him the rights to it, and we've given it to the denomination to use any way they want. So it's very new. It's only a few weeks old. And it was originally done actually on an iPad, the artist who for 30 years was a traditional painter and then now uses the iPad. So there's a high resolution version of it. So stay tuned. I'll make sure you can get it if you want to put it on something. It's not like these are all knockoffs of a painting. There is no painting. It's a high resolution digital iPad production. So take that home with you. And again, I'm sorry I didn't have the ones printed in Spanish, but we do have it in Spanish. In terms of training an evangelist in our denomination, which is my particular calling, I don't care about evangelism in general. I'm just going to say that. That's not my calling. My calling is this denomination. So I actually don't have a lot of interest in talking to people that say, like, well, I'm not really in it for the Episcopal Church. Like, I'm in the Episcopal Church, but I'm really all about Jesus. I'm like, okay, I see this differently. I actually think that's also a very privileged statement you can make. I mean, it depends how much you need the Episcopal Church if you make a statement like that. I don't care about these buildings. You know, God may have other plans. I get that. I think you're right to not have idols. Idolatry is a bad thing. But in a conversation once, Nadia Bolz-Weber, who some of you follow, said something very interesting about denominations. My curiosity was, you know, why are there so many denominations and should we all merge, you know? And she had a really good take on it. She said, there is so much going on in any one gospel, much less four of them, that one denomination cannot bear the burden of ritualizing and forming people in all of the realities that come through in the gospels. We just need, for now anyway, we just need Baptists to like go whole hog on that. Put your jacuzzi right there. And her whole thing is that let's learn about baptism from Baptists. And learn about grace from Lutherans. I'm like, yeah, of course you took grace. Yeah, I know. She took that one. But I love that view. That we are not meant to be schismatic, we are not meant to be apart, but we are called to take the gospel and share it with the world. And her whole thing is that's just a lot for one denomination. There are only so many rituals you can do. Can you imagine if it would be like a state fair, foot washing was going on over here, healing, demons, exorcism, you know, like there's a lot going on. So denominations kind of break it up. And as a result, more of the story, instead of playing telephone where one person tells one person and the burden is always on one person to tell everything they heard, imagine if every time you told a story, you told it to 1,000. And then they went and told it to 1,000 and you could help each other along the way with parts we've forgotten. So I'm in this work. I am an Episcopal evangelist. Not because I want there to be different denominations, but because as a gay person, just that's my one little story. I need this denomination, a denomination that practices what I believe to be the sacramental truths of the Bible and our history. This tradition, I can go to an all-gay church. You know, I'm young enough and old enough that I do remember there used to be like metropolitan community churches and you go into a room full of gay people. And to me, it just kind of feels like O positive or whatever the blood type is that's universal donor. You know, they had a little bit of sacrament going on over here. They had a little bit of kind of transcendentalism over here and this little like, you know, Buddhist little garden thing over here. And I get it. It was a room full of people who have been abused by the violence of bigotries. But the space they created to me was everything and to me, nothing. So, and I'm like, I also don't want to be in a room full of just gay people. Because we have as many jerks and fools and wicked people as anybody else. So that to me it was safe. And I understand why. And I don't want to knock it. Because there are people who are older than I am that will look at me and say, my life was threatened. Trying to find a spiritual life in a spiritual community in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s. I get it. I'm just saying, for me, I walked in there as a denominational geek and said, what are your rituals? How old are they? Where do they come from? What do you think of the second century, the third century? What did the Enlightenment do to this? What did the Renaissance do to this? What did the plague do to this? What did the Crusades do to this? And people are like, welcome. So the question for you, before we even talk about evangelism, is what are you evangelizing for? Please don't tell me Jesus, because there's no such thing as a mere Christian. I'm a big C.S. Lewis buff. I've written about Lewis, published about Lewis, gone around the world and talked about C.S. Lewis, went to his grave and laid on it and talked to him about things. I'm a fanatic. But even in the book called Mere Christianity, he then goes on to say that the Lord's Supper is essential to Christianity. And a few other things. The book called Mere Christianity presents Anglican Christianity as the mere Christianity. This idea that Jesus is enough is the foundation of any Christianity. But this desire to say that we are in a denomination that has other convictions, but that we don't care, then we really have to stop doing this because it costs a lot of money to have the symbol sites that we do. And if you really don't care about them, I can't imagine how joyless your involvement in church is. But I was saying yesterday about the steps going up to an altar and how every altar space represents the Garden of Eden and Mount Sinai and the Mount of Olives and all the different symbols and how it's a Bible study to walk through a sanctuary because you have, that's over there because of Numbers. That's over there because of Deuteronomy. That's over there because of Jeremiah. All that over there is over there because of Isaiah. There's a reason and there's life and there's truth. I have so many friends who are so upset that we use the word Jew in the Friday liturgy for Good Friday, right? You've all heard about these. People want to stop using, and I agree, that translation is incorrect. The real translation in the original language is Judean, okay? Judean, which was a very particular group that the Christian community at the time had a beef with. When I say Christian, I mean the Jesus people. Does that make sense? And someone has decided to translate that as Jews, this collective thing. So I would like to see that. But I find it fascinating that the same progressives that like myself, who are upset about that word, want to come into our tradition and take away any of these Hebrew Bible references. Silence, remove our connection to the covenant before Jesus. So the people who are like, look, I'm not interested in buildings anymore. I just think people, it should just be a home altar. And we don't need any of that. We don't have time for me to go through. In that church I was at that I told you about not long ago, I found 51 references to Hebrew scriptures standing in just any old Episcopal church. 51! All of them from the Hebrew Bible, by the way. So if you want to, at the table you're at right now, you want to say, this is the only altar that I'm interested anymore because I believe Jesus can meet me here, which is true. Then don't say you care about anti-Semitism. Because that's just a decision to say we're going to move to a place in our tradition where we're not interested in what came before us or before Jesus. So, again, it's about calling. So I hope that you can say your prayers as you think about being an evangelist and say, here's the authenticity, where have I met God? A lot of you met God in the liturgies of our church. But then as soon as you get involved, it's like, now we got to share the faith, so keep it simple, stupid. So when you go to the dog park, don't talk about sacraments, because that's hard to understand, and no one's taken any time to help you understand how you would talk about sacraments. So don't talk about that. So the Bible's important. Let's just talk about the Bible. Put the verses everywhere. I agree. But how about the verses about the living water for baptism, the verses about the bread of life for our Eucharist? Does that make sense? That a church that gets insecure and afraid and worried about numbers and decline falls into what I believe Screwtape would love us to do, which is just sheer mere Christianity. Christianity in general. Christianity that isn't that hard to explain. Think how hard you are to explain to somebody. Is the answer for you to have more friends more quickly that you just stop saying anything about yourself that is idiosyncratic, takes a long story, and you just say things like, oh, Mom, I don't know, I like ice cream. That doesn't offend anybody. Meanwhile, there's so many things that are true about you where God has met you and formed you and bled and wept with you. So don't do in your evangelism what I hope you don't do in your lives, which is to keep yourself simple, stupid, so you don't scare anybody in a dog park and no conversation goes longer than you think is socially acceptable. So this is kind of my call in our denomination. I don't think I'm the only person, but this is a different thing you're about to hear, which is how would we train people in the kind of evangelism that says, I believe God has called me to a particular version of the inheritances of scripture and tradition. And I recognize for some Christians, this is one of the only places they are safe to meet God. Maybe including yourself. Share the faith that you have found in Christ, no matter how complicated it is. A lot of it is full of white supremacy. So do you just want to, like a hot potato, just drop it and say, I'm just going to quote Bible verses. As if those aren't problematic. But sooner or later, we have to reckon with the role of humans in history. And in every form of mere Christianity, there's as much trouble as in your personal form of odd Christianity. Trust me. Ever since the Garden, the human desire to say, I want to know, I believe that knowing things will keep me safe from the things of which I am afraid, that's been from the beginning. This book was very interesting. I taught an evangelism course at a seminary, at Virginia Seminary, which is what I do. And at the last minute, I thought, I want people to come along in this course and actually have like a shared daily devotional. So very quickly, I worked on this and had it published in time for the course to begin. So it actually, this daily devotional began the day of the course and ended on the last day of class. People, and I put it on Amazon so the students could buy it, remember, because a lot of them were off-site. Well, it turns out of 250 other people bought it who weren't in the course and followed along. So many that we created like a digital community, and I would give videos each week about things that were happening in the devotional. I'll show you in a minute with the parts of it. But it ended on May 6th. Everyone's like, why May 6th? I'm like, because that was the last day of class. These are people that had no idea this was a course resource. So what I did was I have tapped other people. My original dream was to have a daily devotional that had some important questions for formation, that had what I called an ancient theological reading, something from the first 4 or 5 centuries of the church, something most people have never seen before. Do you know what I mean? Little short sermons on grace, on Easter, on sin, on exorcism from the 2nd century or the 5th century. Other times of plague and war. At the height of the Roman Empire, what was the sermon? At the fall of the Roman Empire, what was the sermon? Really introduce people to phrases, and it is amazing. I don't need to tell you. It is amazing to read the resonance that you can have with someone writing at the end of the Roman Empire about truth and lies and propaganda and tribalism. And then you realize this is written in 385. I wanted people to feel less lonely about the chaos in our lives. So, but every day there was also a quotation from Harry Potter, Narnia, different days, Lord of the Rings, and Harry Potter, Lord of the Rings, Star Wars. Thank you. And I wrote a quotation. I found quotations for each one. So that's how it worked. A breviary, by the way, is a daily prayer book. That binds communities together. Many monastic communities write their own. Does that make sense? So a breviary is—it's a kind of thing, but it's not the same everywhere. We could have a—you could have a Kanuga breviary, and it would be the prayers for the day. The daily office would be in it, but you'd have your own flavor. So here were the contents, and the reason I'm telling you this is I wanted this book to train evangelism. So the contents: every day you had these three questions. One word: describe your relationship with God. You're like, we have to answer the same question every day? Yes, because I find that week 2, week 4, month 4, you have to start digging for other words. Deeper and deeper. How do you describe your relationship with God? Not just how it's going, but how do you describe it? What is it? And to be asked every single day. And some people said it was very powerful for them that they actually were using the same word. Does that make sense? Week after week. But they went deeper with that word. What does it mean to say essential or grounding? And to say it every day and then meditate on that. So you can't go wrong. And then grateful and prayerful. So these were everyday questions. Then, this is the contents, by the way, so this is just, then we had the epic inspiration. So on Mondays, there was a quotation from Narnia. Tuesdays was Lord of the Rings. Sorry, it gets smaller. Wednesdays, Star Wars. Thursdays was Harry Potter. Fridays, in the new version, is going to be Black Panther. Because hobbits are white. And Harry is white. And I wanted a more modern epic and a more diverse epic. So in the next volume, it's going to have, Fridays are going to be Black Panther Days for Wakanda Wisdom. Then there's the collect for the day to connect this to the liturgical year, which is one of my core things. And the way we teach evangelism formation at Virginia Seminary is we ground ourselves in the liturgical year. That's the program. That's the program of the catechumenate from the 2nd century. So that's good enough for us. This is how we formed faith under Nero, who was a crazy real estate magnate that burned down half of Rome because he didn't like poor people. So if you don't think there's any connection between medieval monarchs and any time in history, it's there. And when you could if you could form Christians when Christianity was an invitation to death, I'll take that program. So every day, the collect of the day, and on good days, I was able to sort of match the quotation from the stories to the collect of the day. Then there's the ancient reading. You're not supposed to read this. I just wanted to show you the length of what these ancient readings are. Does that make sense? So there's like one page. It's one paragraph. And by the way, in the ancient world, many of the sermons were this long. Or it's a letter from Augustine to somebody else. Or it's a testimony from Egeria, who's this female saint who goes to the Holy Land in like the 3rd century. She travels there and chronicles everything she sees. She's like the de Tocqueville of Christianity and tells us about ancient liturgies. We know more about that from that saint So her voice is in there. But this is about how long it is. But here's the thing that Jay has talked about too, raising the bar. This is a daily reading. It's a whole page. And the youngest is maybe the 7th century. But there's like a Yoda quotation above it on the same idea. And then there's an antiphon for each day because antiphons are awesome. Okay? And antiphons are many cases, ancient phrases about Scripture. They're like theological statements. It's like overhearing a conversation of believers from the beginning of time. Common, they're like one sentence commentary. The Lord is great indeed. The Lord is risen indeed. How beautiful are the mountains declaring the glory of God. These are antiphons. So there's one every day just to introduce people. Because remember, in the communion of saints, antiphons are being sung right now. This room is very crowded. The goal of a breviary like this, the reason I used epic narratives is to invite people into this epic, real, that everything you loved about Narnia, everything you loved about the Room of the Requirement, everything you loved about those epic stories, those are all just metaphors for the truth. That it is crowded in here. That we believe in the resurrection of the dead and the life everlasting. And I was like, what's a daily way to kind of remind people? So for me, it's not about saying take down the buildings, decentralize Sunday, and try to somehow teach people to do church in their own places. My whole thing is that's a false choice. But how do we each day help people who are growing into the knowledge and presence of Christ each day have a thing, have something, a shared practice, shared prayers? The daily office is the backbone of this, but how do we present it to people so that it doesn't just look like sort of calisthenics all day? And then on Fridays, like Lisa mentioned before, we have the examine. And in the book, I define the examine, what is it, where it's from, how to do it, all kinds of suggestions, you can learn about it. And in the feedback I got from the hundreds of people that use the breviary, some of them, this was their favorite thing. Most people had never even heard of it. They got this book because they heard that there was Yoda quotes in it. Fine. They're a big Harry Potter head and their mom gave it to them. We had youth groups that were using it, young adult groups were using it, a retirement community was using it, a vestry read it. So there's all different age groups. But they to be introduced to this practice of meditating on your week on Fridays for many people was life-giving. And then on Fridays, you had to say who or what won the week. Again, your life is an epic narrative. That's why you love Wakanda. That's why you, there's something about Middle Earth and the Shire, the idea that you can live in the Shire only so long. If there's evil somewhere else, the way Gandalf kind of says to the hobbits, like, you can either face evil now, you can go face it, or you can just wait until it comes here. But the structural, what we would call systemic evil in the world, is coming for the Shire. That doesn't mean that you should be paralyzed in fear, but it does mean you should pack light and come with me now, which is what our Lord says to us all the time. In this world, you will have trouble, but take heart. I have conquered this world. Pack light and go where I've gone. Go where I've been victorious already, but go. That's why we love these stories. Okay, now we're going to do a little bit of how you might want to teach this kind of evangelism that says, let's begin with the liturgical year. Like, where are we right now? We're in Pentecost. This, to me, is the season of evangelism. Now, St. Paul says you have to, you know, preach and the gospel in season and out. But remember, the reason he says that is because there is a season and an out season. And in our whole cycle, remember, in Advent, we have this waiting. We're waiting for the second coming of the world. Remember, we're not just waiting for Jesus to be born in the creche in our neighborhood town square. Remember, the first 2 weeks of readings in Advent are about the second coming, the end of the world, the judgment. That's what we're waiting for, joyfully belonging to the Lord. And then the second, the whole Mary stuff doesn't really even kick in, really, till week 3 and 4, where we focus on that coming. So that's important. Then we have the arrival of Christ. So this is still the story of God toward us, right? And then the story that Joseph is the first one to hear, you know, or I should say then Elizabeth. And then you birth, remember the shepherds who are the kind of essential workers? right around, but it goes larger. Then you have the kings who come representing the world. So there's like the concentric circles in the water that's coming out. Then we have wonderful celebrations during that time of year, like Candlemas, if any of you have it, time in the year where we've moved kind of far away from the birth of Christ in the world. And certain parts of the climate are colder or darker, but not all. But the idea is it's a dark time that as we're moving further away, but we haven't yet moved toward the resurrection kind of cycle. So that's an incredible feast to celebrate. But then what happens is we start preparing ourselves for Lent, right? And we drop the word alleluia. Remember, because the word alleluia simply is a greeting to the Lord, right? So the reason we don't sing it as the gospel is because we're acknowledging that during that period, our Lord, who does meet us in Scripture, it's not that Jesus doesn't show up in the gospels during Lent, but we're acknowledging that our Lord has gone somewhere we can't go to do something we can't do that we don't deserve. And we say that alleluia to Easter because what we're saying is you're back. You went on, you left us, you loved us, but you went and you defeated death. And now we say alleluia again. And then we go through the Easter season, right? And we end on, here's the thing. I said this yesterday, the Ascension, 40 days after Easter. A lot of churches tell me, like, no, we don't celebrate Ascension Thursday, you know, because people don't come to church, so we do it Sunday, sort of, but other things are going on. That, like, breaks my heart, because 40 days after stuff, in the biblical tradition, in the Hebrew Scriptures, in the New Testament, great things happen right after the 40 days. It is always a moment of transformation. That's why Thursday really matters, because you wake up the next day and we then have 9 days right until Easter, this holy period. Jesus could have been like gas clutch. Jesus could have gone up and the Holy Spirit could have come down. That's not what happened. 9 days passes. That's where we get the Latin term novena. A prayer of 9 days refers to that original 9 days. And now my, you know, distant relatives will just say, oh, we're going to pray a novena for you. That means you're really in trouble. They're not just going to pray for you. They're going to pray for 9 days. But it's a reference to that 9 days. Where they didn't know Pentecost was coming. They had to trust. They had to discern their gifts. How do we go forward? The Lord is risen indeed. But now what? Can you imagine if your evangelism preparation in your congregation was based in the liturgical year and you did something on Thursday online, something that you sent to them on Facebook, emails, or some kind of liturgy, well, only 5 or 6 people would come. Well, that's half the number of the gospel. I mean, half the number of the disciples. 5 is plenty to have a liturgy. Just make sure your whole community knows it's happening. And start and post on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram or whatever you do for 9 days. What is God saying to you? What is God saying to you? Where do you see Christ in the world? And have 9 days of discerning and looking and looking and looking, knowing that you took a vow to seek and serve Christ in all people. 9 days. And then celebrate at Pentecost, not just, I don't know, fire. I always see random acts of pyrotechnics on the internet in our denomination. Everyone gets the idea about fire, and then they invite people in 10 different languages to read the gospel. Okay, I get it, that diversity is important, but then the next day, that's nothing to do with anything. You didn't know you had someone that speaks Ethiopian in your church, now you do. That's not unimportant. But the idea is Pentecost is a gift to people who are seeking, where do we go now? They're looking for their pillar of fire, going back to the Old Testament, to lead us forward. So do you see how there's a way in which, without buying a new program, if you just go deep in a liturgical year, and by the way, at Pentecost, that's the season right now. Of harvest, of green. We waited for Jesus to come. He came. We waited to watch our Lord do what only he can do, which is to redeem the world. Then he was resurrected and walked around and cooked fish and other cool stuff and explained to us things that we didn't get the first time around. And then he ascends and we blow out the candle and say, we got this, but we're terrified. And we spend 9 days saying, what will you have us do? Why did all this happen? What does the resurrection mean? Where are your people hurting? Where am I hurting? And that Pentecost is God breathing back into those dreams and anxieties so that you would go out. So that's where we are right now. This is the season of evangelism. And then it will happen as we come toward, and remember, this is big, we have big saints days for the next couple of months. And then just so we didn't leave anyone out, kind of like the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, we have the Feast of All Saints. Just to make sure, you know, that we didn't leave anybody out, we have a whole feast. And what happens right after that feast, after we have spent this whole green season with all these important feast days of gospel writers and things like that, it's a reminder to us of what the life of faith looks like. And then, boom, we go back into realizing who is the energy, who is the power, and we go into Advent. This is, of course, a box of salt. And it got me thinking that we're supposed to be salt and light and leaven in the world. So there's something about salt that is an evangelist. So then I thought, okay, well, what's in salt? Like, what are the ingredients? And if we think of salt as an evangelist, What are the ingredients of an evangelist? You see what I did there? This was Morton salt. Morton salt. Did you see that? Bueller. Never, maybe didn't see that. And Gentile and kosher, we're all called to be evangelists. So if you turn this box of salt over, here are the ingredients of an evangelist. And I say this, here's my authoritative confidence. Evangelism is not just a set of techniques, unless you've decided that's all it is. Then it's really marketing. It's sharing ideas. So I am actually not a fan of evangelist training as if people don't know how to share things they like. I don't actually think that's our problem. I think children at 4 years old who have put on their own shoes that day for the first time are going to tell you why they love those shoes. I actually don't believe in teaching that. Because the other problem when you teach evangelism just as a set of techniques, if you're not an extrovert, it all feels awkward. It's actually quite cruel to look at a room full of people who are left-handed and say, Jesus wants you to write with your right hand. Not that you should go to the edge and take risks, but that you should literally communicate with other people in ways that bring you physical stress and trauma. If I said to you all right now, okay, we're all going to get in a bus and we're all going to go downtown to wherever downtown is here. I'm from New York. You have a downtown or something, right? You have something that's down? Okay, come to the mountain. Right! Yay! And I said, and you guys are going to pair up, and you're going to go talk to people about Jesus. There are a few of you in here that were like, this is what I was waiting for. And others of you are like, I wouldn't have come to this session. So I want to honor who God has made you to be. The devil loves universal evangelist training that is basically training in extroversion. Because it's a recipe for insecurity and shame. Meanwhile, as Anglicans, we believe God speaks through beauty and poetry and breeze and music and love and sex and silence and noise. All these areas, you could have gifts to arrive with the Christ that is in you. And instead we say, now here's how you start a conversation. I'm not a fan. As an extrovert, I don't like things that force me to be an introvert, and I'm assuming it's the same for you. And if we believe that God has made you wonderfully, then we need to find evangelism training that acknowledges how each of you are wonderfully made, you wonderful, crazy introverts. Who are you? I don't even know. But so many of the saints that we honor, if you know a lot about the saints' lives, I don't want to say most of them are introverts, but a heck of a lot of them are. Yeah. This list is going to be something that's kind of terrifying because it has some long words in it. But what I want to say is I would rather you leave feeling that evangelism, to really train an evangelist, is something that feels almost too hard to do it in a way that is true to our tradition, what about the nonverbal autistic teenager in your community? Use that person as a test of your evangelism training. If whatever you're doing does not include them, that's just techniques. That is just techniques. Theological anthropology. Gosh, that's a funny way of saying it. What's your view of human nature? Do you believe, along with Calvin, that we are totally depraved? 5 points of Calvinism, if you know anything about that. Or do you have the Anglican view, which is we are broken. The fall was bad. Kind of like, I look like I just came from the garden. The fall was bad. But you can have moral knowledge and goodness and kindness and common grace, whether or not you've ever heard of God. So it's called theological anthropology. It's what's your view of humanity informed by our conviction that all of us are created in the image of God. I love Presbyterians, but quite often if I have more than 1 minute to talk to them, I'm like, what the heck is up with your theology? Come on. Biblical theology. Basically, what's your view of the Bible? Not do you know a verse? What is the Bible? Does the church grow out of the Bible, that our job as a church is to obey the Bible? Or did the Bible, hint, grow out of the church? That the Bible is a fruit of the church, not the other way around. This is the difference between you and the megachurch in your community. The church is not the fruit of the Bible in that way. The Bible is the fruit of the people of God, of the Holy Spirit moving, as our church councils and creeds and things like that. These are fruits of the Spirit moving in humanity. Doesn't mean they're not inspired. Trust me, I'm very conservative on this. But you are not called to obey Scripture. The Scripture is the fruit of this plant, the church, the tree of life, the cross. It is so much easier to go into a dog park, the reason I'm doing this with you today, and have confidence in your faith if you understand it for yourself. If you did a YouTube video just yesterday, you watched it on how to change a tire, and then you walked into a community tomorrow and someone started asking you about changing tires, you would know something. You could actually pull out your phone and maybe watch that again. But what if someone said, I don't know that, what's this balancing thing or rotation? And you'd be like, oh, I don't know. I know how to change a tire. I don't know anything about cars. I can't sit here and problem solve with you and be creative. That's what it looks like to just know a technique. In my experience, if you aim for techniques, one, you're going to make more than half our church feel insecure and uncomfortable because they're not extroverts, and the training you're doing is basically training and talking. And the other thing that'll happen is people are just a mile wide and an inch deep, and they're not going to engage in hard conversations with their brother-in-law at Thanksgiving because they know what they don't know. We all know what a smart person in an area sounds like, the quilter, the knitter, the fly fisher. You know what knowledge looks like, and I just think that the church continues to show us by declining numbers and uncomfortableness with evangelism. People are telling us, they're voting with their feet, you have not formed us, and now you want us to go tell people about the faith. That is not fair. We have a formation crisis, and the answer is not to start doing more evangelism. It's mean. I would love to skip over the formation crisis. I just jumped to something sexy like evangelism. But it's mean. To the world as well. If you don't know what to say to your Jewish dermatologist about your own faith, please don't say anything. Because the meanness isn't just us being mean against people who aren't talkers. It's mean to the world. Jesus did not come to judge the world. He came to save it. Do you know how to share that? So biblical theology is really important. We got to know what we mean by the word of God. Sacramental theology, just another long phrase, but we believe the broad church conviction of this denomination that I feel called is that we meet in baptism and Eucharist, the great sacraments. Capital letters are very important in the Book of Common Prayer. They mean things. These are the two great sacraments. Do we know what happened? The example I gave, I wrote a book called What is Evangelism? And one of the things that I say is, I just wish I would walk into a church, and quite often, because I'm a church sort of, I was a canon for a bishop and visit a lot of churches, and quite often someone is standing right in front of the altar after the service, and when I say, what's going on in this church, they would point to a bulletin board, and they're standing in front of the altar, or they're leaning on the font. And I'm like, so what exciting things are happening in this church? They're like, oh, check our website. I'm like, you have nothing to say about the font? Nothing? I'm glad you have a silent auction or whatever that is over there. But people, we haven't formed people to look at someone and say, look at this font. Do you know why it has eight sides? Because in the 7 days of creation, God rested on the seventh, and the eighth day, which is the beginning of the rest of time, baptism is the eighth day. It's what you can do. You're baptized for life. For life, not for salvation. You'd be beamed up out of the water. You're baptized for life. I would love if I go into someone's church and say, what's happening here? And they just said, I don't know where to start. There's an altar over there with the God of creation on the cross. See that cross right there, right up there? That's the tree of life. And the one who eats from that will live forever and will walk in the garden and whisper with God without shame. Or we could start here at the font, where everything I've been dragging with me, like a hot air balloon tied to the ground in 100 places, one sacrament cuts the rope and you go. And I'm not going to sit here and tell you that we actually have a thrift store if you go down in the basement, and that's what's going on here. The truth is, I love that there's a thrift store. But justice work is not a substitution. That's human work. It's not a substitution for the testimony that we are living in this denomination. Someone will say, oh my gosh, did you just say justice work is like not the most important thing? Okay, if you want to have a philosophical conversation about what it means to like that we don't even have a hierarchy of virtues and values, we'll have that philosophical conversation. You were not saved for work. God doesn't need us to do anything Can you imagine the thrift shop Jesus could run? Okay? The Trinity needs no help from us. We are given opportunities to feed on the tree of life. And when we have the food, we just can't stand, I hope, that the world is starving in any other way. Just two more. Ecclesiology. What is the church? The pandemic has really brought us into this area. What is the church? What's the church for? Remember, Rowan Williams gave us a good thing. To form the kind of people who can receive the gifts that God wants to give. Remember, if the only gift you teach someone is how to receive gifts, they're going to receive everything. If you try to teach them how to receive a certain gift, that might be, even if they do well in your training, that will be the only gift they know how to receive. Seek first the kingdom and all these other things will come to you. Our evangelism has to help people open their hearts and hands, and then God can give them anything. Any other thing, any other motivation in evangelism, to hand them anything of yours, especially in a white, supremacist, colonial, imperial church as ours. I don't want to hand anybody that. But in communion, in this denomination that has saved my life, I want to help people be formed to receive whatever gift, whatever faith, I don't know, whatever vocation. It works for all ages. And lastly, eschatology. There's a word you can go home and say, like, Kanuga. Just from a Greek word, eschaton, the end times. Where do you think this is all going? If I have one more conversation with a leader in our church that says, I don't want to talk about that. I don't know. I'm like, wow. Because they're afraid to say the things that are in all of our Eucharistic prayers. All things in subjection under your Christ. Every knee will bow. And people are so ashamed by those phrases because we haven't done formation that they're like, I don't want to hurt anybody. So I just, a lot of them say, like, I just want to talk about now. God is love, love. God is love, right? But the truth is that's more insecurity. I am so confident of how this story ends. That doesn't mean I understand it. But the work that began at the cross and came out of the grave, I just believe that is the end of the story. I read the first page of the novel from the beginning. I know where this is going. So I lay this out to you that if you were ever to do a workshop, if you were ever to have a vestry retreat, if you were ever to have a parish retreat, these words are loaded. You know what I'm saying? Like, these are kind of thick words. You have to kind of break it down. But I just want you to know that in my experience and the research I have done with parishes where people, whether they have these words or not, are constantly, every season, being trained in these things from children on. Their churches are growing because wherever those people go in the world, they're prepared to give an answer for the hope that they have. They also realize that evangelism training is an invitation to go deeper into your own faith. So if you're a nonverbal artistic person, you're living in a community that has these rhythms like the catechumen at Lisa was talking about, and you're experiencing the grace of the sacraments and the growth of the people. So I just don't see any other way to confident evangelism other than taking apart what the system of our faith is. Because someone could say, I don't believe in some of these things. I'm not this kind of Christian. My whole thing is great. I mean, we have, congregationalism is a great thing. There, John Wesley was done with us. That we didn't read the Bible enough. I'm sad we lost him. On the other hand, it was a divorce that has brought another tradition, like Nadia Boles-Weber said. Does that make sense? That has sort of a learning, teaching, and meditating on Scripture that was not fitting in our denomination. God bless both of us. I know myself as a priest. I will not teach a kind of evangelism as if this denomination doesn't matter and then make you, the lay people, pay my salary anyway. And my pension. It's a matter of integrity for all of us. Think about our denomination. Think about where you've met Christ. And share that set of experiences. And the great thing about the liturgical year is the language is given to you. And it also means if you don't speak at all, if you engage with that story, engage with that epic narrative. That's why, we had that book that had some invitations to get people's, like, epic narrative part of their brain thinking. And there is room for every kind of person in the community. And some of you and some of us do like to talk. But I do have to say that you can talk to me afterward. And if you have more questions about, like, what kind of language you could use, like human nature or what is the Bible, this could be a series you could do once a week. We actually have research. So this is a lot of what Jay Seidbotham has already been saying. It is very hard to ask people to share, in this day and age, something that they know less about than a product they were at least able to read the reviews on Amazon. So let's not create insecure people. Let's create people who know the story of God in their lives. In this tradition, so these are some parts, but we can talk afterward if you think that there's something else. You might say, what about music? That's the kind of thing that can run through all of this. Do you know what I mean? What about prayer? That's the kind of thing that can run through all of this. I'm just gonna stop. There's like a lot of other things I can show you. End on this. How many of you read the letter from the Birmingham jail? Okay, good, right. Have any of you just said, I wish I could write something like that? And it's long, and for those of you who maybe don't know this part of it, remember it was written on the margins of newspaper. That's the only paper that he had in the jail, with shards of different pencils, that he actually wrote this in the margins with no notes and no library next to him, and gave what is one of the most, I think, coherent presentations of Christian theology, not just in the 20th century, maybe in the English language. What I love about it is there's very little in there that is Baptist theology. These things that I've listed right here, this is literally an outline of the letter from the Birmingham jail. He is able to explain to people, how do you break a law without committing a sin? And shows that certain laws are unjust laws vis-a-vis God and Scripture and Revelation, and therefore to obey them, right, would be to break moral law. We're not going to go through the letter of the Birmingham jail. I just want you to realize that if you've ever read that letter and said, I wish I could write something like that, or sing something like that, you know, something according to your personality, you know, craft something from clay like that, it's because he knew these things. You can make an author of that letter. Our church has looked at it and said, that's going to be too hard. All of you are formation people. You know there are a lot of people that want to go to the silent auction or they want to do the egg hunt. Do you know what I mean? They're literally, remember Jay had a couple of quotations that were like, I'm not here for spiritual growth. This is hard. This is hard. But God's abundant life is in it. And if you want to be able to be a congregation or an individual that if you wound up in a situation you had to explain, why are you in jail and that's somehow not wrong? Ask yourself, where are you on these things? I want to apologize that normally if we did sort of more of a workshop, here's what I would suggest you do. Either have a night on each one of these things, an adult forum on them, online, Zoom, and you would break people up into groups of two or three and say to them, what is, you have to define it, your view of human nature, and talk amongst yourselves. In my experience, even with seminary students, when we broke up into groups, people were all over the place in each of these categories. But the majority of people said, I think that's right, right? In seminary. And I just put my head in my hands and I just felt like our denomination has decided to fight so many wars in the last 75 years and one of them is not true formation. And it's not that we haven't fought brave wars, but politically and everything else, but what the result is an insecurity that is baked into Episcopalians and people think the result is that we have people who don't know how to talk about their faith. My whole thing is how many people go back to the picture of the woman with Jesus, how many people can name that kind of encounter with our Lord? That's what we haven't provided. And you can train people to talk all you want. The question is, have we formed people to recognize the story that God is doing in their own lives? I'm going to stop here and ask, there's a mic here, but I don't think you need it. What your reactions are? Do any of you have a question? Do you have a response? Have any of you seen formation done about evangelism and growing in your church based in the beliefs as opposed to a practice? I'd love to hear. Or you could just respond to something I've said and throw a tomato or... Go ahead, Aaron. Pampered Chef?
Yeah. Any of those things you sell, catalogs,
uh-huh.
And they put Amway, and if you're in school and I'm studying leadership, they want to know your why.
Yeah.
And being an extrovert like you are, I sometimes find myself talking around versus talking. It's hard to narrow it down, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. I know
And they looked at you and said, I could never do what you do. I've often said, Bishop Curry, who is a friend, and I'm on his evangelism cabinet, and but I and I've said this to his face. The joke I have is like that. I worry that people will do Simon Says, like do something because he did it, or say something or preach the way he preaches, because it's amazing. And I wonder, Aaron, how many people have that experience when they hear great preachers in our church, their reaction. And this is Satan. I'm just going to say it. You could never do that. You don't talk like that. You're not that smart. So what you're watching right now is incredibly inspiring. But it's not an invitation, because that's not who you are. That's the problem when we've turned evangelism into the ability to do it the way that person does it, or that person does it. And when you have a week where you have all the children share a piece of Play-Doh that is God, or some question that you have them do, and everyone sees that, and you call that month evangelism in Sunday school. And everyone is looking at the things people have made. And you, like little tiny, like micro attempts in formation to have people to put the word, like you've heard here, put scripture everywhere. Put the word evangelism everywhere, because it's everywhere in the Eucharistic prayers. I'm working on another book with a friend of mine who's a liturgist, and it's going to be evangelism in the Book of Common Prayer. And we're just going to be pulling out from all the liturgies and the pastoral offices the explicit calls to evangelism. The funny thing is they're in there, but because we haven't formed as a church around that, we think it'll be helpful to have like a commentary of all the liturgies and that in the Book of Vocational Services. How could you translate this into evangelism imagination for your congregation? Because it's in there. The sending prayers from the Eucharist, just remind people that that's our evangelism is in the sending prayer after every Eucharist. Read it. I mean, it's literally a commissioning.
We are all so steeped in the Episcopal Church, mm-hmm. even though I agree with you, the formation crisis is real. Why can we only explain our church based on what we're not? Mm-hmm.
Anglican theology says we are in relationship with God from the womb on. And I'll take any heat for saying that. God knit us together. And as Augustine said, God, you have made us for your own, and we are restless until we rest in you. There's only one ultimate peace and love and joy and identity in all of history. And it is when the creature is in the loving relationship of the Creator, who is relationship forever. The people in the church know that truth more than most. And in my experience, the ones who have stayed, which are not many, watch people leave because of integrity. That's what breaks my heart. Not people who leave for youth soccer, but who leave because they continue to hear the liturgies and this lofty language about meaning and purpose and vocation and dying to self, and they're given no theological ability to take that in. It's like food without a stomach. No way to digest this. And they've been told hospitality is the greatest of all human virtues. It is one of the highest virtues. But it is not in it of itself the living water. And again, that might be controversial, but I believe we continue to focus on that which is going to make the most amount of people feel comfortable. And the truth is, we know from Augustine and from God, we will be restless until we rest in God. Not something like God, not a philosophy about God, not a set of ideas about God. God, the everlasting arms, through in whom we live and move and have our being. So to answer your question, Our theological anthropology is that there is a black box in every person. It is the image of God in us. This is why Calvin is an idiot. I mean, God loves him, but that makes one of us, all right? And yet, if you know anything about Christian history, Calvin is responding to some very real things, okay? So there's a context to that. But we're not that. We believe that the black box, just like you have to search sometimes for days and go miles and miles under something like the ocean and listen and listen, and finally somewhere you hear that ping. And what do? When you hear it? You go closer and it gets louder. You move further away, it gets softer. This is our view. When I go into a dog park, everyone in there, there's a black box. The image of God is buried deep within every single person. I don't plant that. It's my job to turn up the sound. What brings you joy? What shocked you? What are the mysteries of your life? What good things happened that you didn't see coming? What incredible struggle are you making it through? What tombs are you crawling out of? You're just turning up the volume higher and higher and higher. And when they walk away from you, they are more prepared to receive the gift that God wants to give, which is inside them. Half the Christian denominations in the country would stop with me right there and say, we can't date anymore. The fall was a fall. And what got taken out of us, and by the way, this is actually a Latin phrase, the donum supernaturalia, that's Latin, the spiritual gift, that is to say the image of God. The Reformed traditions believe that is taken out at the fall. In our tradition, we believe it is buried as deep as only Christ can pull it out. But everyone in this room, every human, there has never been from the womb a life without the image of God, the fingerprint of God in that life, making a sound, a joyful noise. And the saints sing right now, constantly singing. There's actually like a refrain to pull it out of us. That's why I do love statues. I do love stained glass windows, because the way the light comes in, it's a reminder that the refrain is getting louder and louder and louder. And evil is in such a fight for that sound. But our sound of Christ is louder. And when you go into Starbucks, listen. Every saint that has come out of a womb is singing. And the person in front of you, it looks like they're just not listening to that sound. It's not yours. Lord, open thou our lips, so our mouth will proclaim our praise. You're the one who opens the lips. You're the one that puts the praise in. So when you say when people have left, you're absolutely right. There is this sense in our tradition that we're not saying that. So people think they have to work at this, and it's exhausting. And then they finally leave because there's no integrity. I can't sell a product I don't even use. And the problem then isn't to teach me how to sell products. I should just vacuum for a few hours and be like, this Dyson is amazing. Because remember, Jesus could come back this afternoon, right? And end all the things that we're having a little piece of paper that we're, you know, listening we're going to do when we go home. I just think that helps me a lot. That's why eschatology, how this ends, is really important. Because it isn't just how it ends, it's when. We have to kind of hold lightly our plans on earth. One of the great movements of all secular atheist thinking is to just think more about the earth than anything you can't see. But remember, we say it in the creed. We believe in the Lord, the giver of life, and the God of the seen and the unseen. And right now, because of the pandemic, we are petrified about what we see. How are we going to afford it? How are we going to staff it? Where are we going to find things that we see? And my deep, deep prayer is that we enter the great mystery of time at the beginning, where the Holy Spirit came over the waters, spaciousness and peace and God's plan for all creation. So, and the saints, you can't see that. And if Satan loves us counting. One, two, you know, how many people are in this room? Do you know how many people are singing with us right now? I have absolutely no idea. The church is not small. We're done.